I want to thank you, of course, the organizer, for inviting me to this meeting. I have to say it's hard to say no to a meeting in Paris. But second, I heard it's a very exciting meeting, so I hope I can bring some to the meeting as first. Perfect. So I was asked to talk about basis of immunotherapy in myeloma. These are my disclosure slides. So what I decided to do is go over, first, since we start with the biology, go over the myeloma niche, what are the components of the bone marrow microenvironment. Then we'll go over the immunodysregulation known in myeloma. And third, I will go very quickly, we'll talk about the immunostrategy available in myeloma to date. Of course, as you all know, myeloma is a cancer of the plasma cells. They accumulate in the bone marrow where they actually start to proliferate. And we now know very well that there is a very close internship between the plasma cells and the bone marrow microenvironment. This interaction is so important that these cells receive so many signals. They promote their proliferation and develop of drug resistance. As shown in this cartoon, there are three important components of the myeloma niche that we have to consider. Of course, we have the extra medullary matrix that is formed basically from glycoprotein, laminin, fibronectin. We have to consider, of course, the role of soluble component. This includes cytokine, growth factor, and third, we have to consider the cells. And these include hematologic hematopoietic cells, you see, and I will describe the role of dendritic cell, macrophages, MDSC, but also we cannot forget the non-hematopoietic cells, showing here the osteoclasts, osteoblasts, of course, the bone marrow endothelial cells. Now, what we also know very well, and this is work from Dana-Farber, from Nikhil Munshi, and Dr. Anderson, we know now very well that there is an autocrine and paracrine loops, so they are generated, and there is a cell-to-cell adhesion mechanism that regulates the survival of these cells, showing here the key signal pathway that have been identified over the years. You can see on the top PI3 kinase that with AKT and PKC induced proliferation of these cells. Of course, JAK-STAT3 is essential for proliferation of these cells, but you can see also RAF and FKB. And what I want to point out in this slide is mainly all the cytokines that are released through this interaction. We know IL-6 is extremely important, but you can see also APRIL-BAMF recognized as important for the survival of these cells. And of course, we cannot forget about the bone homeostasis that we learn in myeloma patients is also dysregulated. In particular, through the production of RANK lichen, DDK1, we know that there is an activation of osteoclasts that induce the bone lytic lesion we see in our patient. And of course, there is also the role of other growth factor, VGF, hepatocyte growth factor that induce angiogenesis that basically feed even more the bone marrow microenvironment. But with this in mind, what we know exactly about the role of how these myeloma cells really escape the tumor, the recognition by the immune system. We know, for example, that during the myeloma evolution, there are a lot of immunodysregulation that have been identified. There is a loss of immunosurveillance that foster, of course, disease progression and, of course, drug resistance. And what we know today in myeloma is that the number of B cells, NK cells, CD4 positive T cells are, of course, reduced and impaired, but there are key components in bone marrow milieu that are known to be dysregulated. And then we'll go over this dysregulation in the next few slides. First of all, dendritic cells are known to be reducing number in the myeloma patient versus control, and they are known very well that through a direct interaction between CD28 on the plasma cells and CD80/86 on the dendritic cells, this interaction induces the production of IL-6, one of the main growth factor of myeloma cells, and also there is a production of this enzyme, IDO, which is known now to be able to reduce one of the amino acid, the arginine, is essential for T cell activity. So not surprising, through this interaction, the T cells are actually enabled to be reactivated. We also know that these dendritic cells also are able to produce additional growth factor that inhibit, they actually induce a more they are able to induce the T cells to become more T regulatory T cells. These are immunosuppressive. They are known to express high CD25, FOXP3, and also to be CD4 positive. What about now CD4 positive cells? We know that also the production of these cells are affected by the microenvironment, and patients with myeloma are known to have a very little TH1 phenotype. They don't produce much interleukin-2, interferon gamma. Now, the reason why the immunity is lacking on this patient. But they are known to be more TH2. They produce interleukin-10, interleukin-4. And very recently, it's been shown they have a lot of TH17 phenotype, which is mainly triggered by the production of TGF-beta, as well as interleukin-6. And very late in the last few years, we also discovered that these TH17 cells are also able to induce the production of interleukin-17 that inhibit even more the activity of this cytotoxic T lymphocyte, and also is known to be involved in the production of RANK ligand, which even more activate the osteoclast. What about the other cells? We know there is a beautiful review recently published in Cancer Cell about the MDSC. These are the myelo-derived suppressive cells. These are cells that are known to be able to, in a way, inhibit the activity of the T cells through the production of arginine-1, through nitrosylation, and also through the production of this reacting oxygen species. So basically what they do, they grow in the bone marrow of this patient, they block the activity of the T cells. They are known also to produce a lot of interleukin-18, recently shown to be able to associate it to poor prognosis because even more inactivate the activity of the T cells. They are known also to induce a differentiation of more of T regulatory cells. And of course, we cannot forget about the macrophages. Macrophages, of course, are attracted to the bone marrow milieu due to the expression of chemokine, mainly CXCL4 and CXCL12. And these macrophages in myeloma are known to be more M2. M2 means they are more tumor promoter, not pro-inflammatory. And they are known to produce several other cytokines, in particular interleukin-10, interleukin-1-beta, they even stop the activity of the T cells, and they are of course known to produce additional growth factor known to promote tumor progression and invasion. What about the myeloma cells? Of course, the myeloma cell itself play an important role in the tumor escape. I have shown you that through the production of all the cytokines, they are recruiting all these immunosuppressive components, but they are also known to really impair the cytotoxicity because they have a very little tumor antigen. So it's easy for a tumor cell to be hiding and not be recognized because they don't have much of this tumor antigen. They are known not to have a lot of HLA costimulatory molecule, in particular CD4 and CD8. They have a low expression of HLA-DR, and they are known to shed MICA, these other important protein that actually inhibit even more the cytotoxicity. And of course, I will mention also the fact that myeloma cells, as well as other tumor cells, they also are able to induce tumor escape because they have an upregulation of several inhibitor ligand, PD-L1, LAG-3, and TASI-1, causing at the end of the day just T cell energy and exhaustion. But why, despite all this immunoregulation, we still talk about immunotherapy in myeloma? We all have a few patients that they actually are now, we consider cure because they were treated with allogeneic stem transplant. We know through a graft versus myeloma effect, they have achieved complete remission. We have cases of donor lymphocyte infusion able to induce and then rescue-induced remission in patients with relapse after allo transplant. And of course, we cannot forget the interferon alpha, one of the first few drugs used to stimulate the immune system, but we all recognize these results are very modest. We cannot, of course, deny the high morbidity and mortality of the transplant. So what I'd like to do in the next few slides, really very briefly give you a flavor of what are the immunotherapeutic strategies available today in myeloma. And I like to divide them in three main strategies. So I will present to you just briefly the agent. They are able to reverse tumor-mediated immunoparalysis. Of course, the IMiDs are on top of the list, as well as the immunocheckpoint inhibitors. We have also agents that are able to target the malignant clone. These are the monoclonal antibody. And of course, we cannot not talk about the agent. They are able today to activate immune cells against the tumor. And of course, we have the CAR T cells, the BiTE, and the vaccine. Let me start then with the IMiDs. Well, of course, the IMiDs are known to have for a long time an anti-tumor effect. And we know very well now that they work through cereblon, this protein, which is an adaptive protein of the CAL4A, DDB1A3 ligase, and is known to induce the proteasomal degradation of two important transcription factors, Icarus and Aiolos. They get degraded. They induce a downregulation of MYCR4, leading to myeloma cell death. But more recently, they have been shown to also to induce production of interleukin-2, interferon gamma. These are data from our own group showing the fact that if we silence IKZF3, we induce an interferon signature, and there is on beam because there is a binding of this Icarus or an Aiolos to promoter of this interferon gene. So I would like to say then the IMiDs have two important functions, and this is why they are so important as a drug in our combination therapy. First, they are able to have an anti-tumor effect. Then they are known to have also what we call an immunomodulatory effect. They induce the production of interleukin-2, interleukin-4, interferon gamma, TNF-alpha, activating at the end of the day T cells and NK cells. So they are really important because they are able to reactivate, expand the immune cells against the tumor. And this is not the case. Of course, it's not surprising. They are now a backbone for several other immunotherapeutic strategy. There is a list here of drugs that can actually is not even complete, but you can see how the IMiDs are playing in combination with every possible other class of drug available in myeloma today. What about now, in the same strategy, we have also other agents that are able to reverse the immunomediated immunoparalysis. Of course, in this class, we have to remember the immunocheckpoint inhibitors. As you may remember, the T cells, they don't only need specific antigen recognition through TCR to be activated. Of course, they are regulated through several other, positive and negative factors. The positive are these activating receptors that you can see on the T cells. They are CD28, 27. What they do when they get engaged, it's like pushing our foot on the gas pedal, so they're able to activate even more our immunity against the tumor. On the other end, we have some other inhibitor receptors, PD-1, for example, or LAG-3, that are actually, when they are engaged by their ligand, they are instead the brakes of the immune system. They actually stop the immune cells to react against the tumor. And what you probably remember from myeloma, now in myeloma world, that they express a lot of these ligand for inhibitor receptors. So at the end of the day, what they do, they break the immune system. They stop the immune cells to react against the tumor. And of course, why PD-1 and PD-L1 has been recognized and been so important in myeloma? The reason, because of course, is known to be expressed, PD-L1 in myeloma cells, although its expression, I want to mention, is very heterogeneous. It's been more described highly expressed in hyperdiploid, relapse refractory myeloma. It's been reported in patients with MGUS, they express PD-L1, they are known to have an increased risk of progression, and they are known to induce also drug resistance through the PI3AKT signal pathway. What about the PD-1? Because, of course, the ligand expressed in the tumor, PD-1 needs to be expressed on the T cells to be activated. And we know that why probably these checkpoint inhibitors by themselves didn't work very well in myeloma, because the T cells of myeloma patients, they don't have a lot of PD-1. And this is also has been shown in this other publication, too, that they actually, the T cells of patients with myeloma, they have a senescent status. When I mean senescence, they don't express CD28, which is the key component of T cell activation, and they express actually CD57, KLRG1, so they are unable to be activated. And I want to show you also some other data we presented recently at ASH, where actually when we look at patients expressed with, treated with daratumumab and pomalidomide, and we perform single cell analysis, we discovered the main difference between patients sensitive to this drug and patient resistant was actually the status of the T cells. That in patient resistant were quite exhausted. You can see they don't have any CD28, but instead they express a large panel of checkpoint inhibitors ligand. In particular, the most expressed in our end was LAG-3, but you can see also TIM-3 and TIGIT-1 expressed. And to confirm other data, also PD-1 was very minimal expressed in this patient cohort. Of course, this is just a summary. There are several immunocheckpoint inhibitors available in cancer, including myeloma. I just point out the pembrolizumab. You will learn more about at this meeting, which actually there are two important phase three ongoing, and they're actually on hold due to some safety concern. Moving on quickly to the second part, we have also agents that selectively target the malignant clone. These are the monoclonal antibody. What they do, basically, they're able to, this is probably what we can call target therapy. They actually go after receptor expressed by tumor cells, and they're able to have to kill directly the tumor, also able to induce and label myeloma cells for killing by NK cells, T cells, and complement. And one example is elotuzumab. This monoclonal antibody goes after SLAMF7, in the past called CS1, expressed in myeloma cells on the NK cells. And this cartoon, just want to mention how, again, even this naked antibody is able to kill directly NK cells because they express SLAMF7, but is also able to tag for recognition myeloma cells through the NK cells. And as you know, it is known to be by single agent, didn't show any activity in myeloma, but in combination with IMiDs has been shown to be quite effective. And of course, daratumumab is one of the best drugs, if I may use this word, for in the immunotherapy in this class of drug, because it's one of the drugs that actually target CD38, which is highly expressed in myeloma cells. It's known, as shown in this cartoon, to directly bind myeloma cells and kill them, also an immunomodulatory effect, because it's also able to activate complement, macrophage, and kill cells against the tumor. It also kills some of these T-regulatory immunosuppressive cells, they express CD38. Of course, this table, when I just mention how many other monoclonal antibodies are coming in the myeloma world. Of course, there are other CD38 available that we will learn more about, and I'm sure at the meeting you will learn about all the daratumumab trial. Finally, I want to mention the third strategy, which is the use of agents that are able to activate immune cells to target the tumor. And of course, CAR T cells are on the top of the list, and is showing in this cartoon, basically CAR T cells is a therapy where we infuse autologous T cells against anti-myeloma. And this is just a cartoon that I want to mention how the therapy is done. Basically, T cells are collected from the patient. They are then modified in vitro, where they actually become CAR T cells. The chimeric antigen receptor is induced, is transduced inside the cells. The cells grow in vitro, and then they are able to be reinfused in the patient. They actually, with the idea of having CAR T cells with cancer cells. This, again, is just a summary of what is available right now. You can see several CAR T cells available in design. Probably the most exciting today, the BCMA, that show promising results. And there are other additional active adoptive therapy available in myeloma. Of course, I cannot not talk about the bites in a slide. These are probably these bispecific antibody. They are able to go after two targets. One is on the T cells, and the other one is on the cancer cells. In a way, it's a way to bypass the need for the antigen presentation via MHC or antigen-presenting cells, engage directly the immune cells, and they are a great promise coming from the phase one of the BiTE anti-BCMA that seems to be showing some sign of response. In this category, of course, we have also vaccine, and there are cell-based vaccine, mainly dendritic cells fused with tumor protein from the cancer, or non-cellular vaccine, and that seems to be promising. But at this point, they're probably less relevant comparing all the other active therapy we have in myeloma. So to summarize this part, hopefully I show you today that we have at least three different strategies available in myeloma. We have shown here in black some drug able to reactivate the immune cells against the tumor. These are the IMiDs, these are the immunocheckpoint inhibitor. Then we have the monoclonal antibody that directly target the cancer cells. And in red, we have a different other strategy that are able to re-stimulate the immune cells against the tumor. But I want to close with one slide on the challenges of immunotherapy today. Why it's not a home run yet, at least what is available today. So it's not a home run because the durability of response is still not there. We know there is a lack of persistence of CAR T cells. There is an antigenic drifting that we have noticed with the CD3A, BCMA, CAR T cells. So we have to improve this immunotherapy and this perspective. Then we know there is the concept of T-cell exhaustion that we have to actually consider. And of course, the fact that some other, even daratumumab is able to kill some NK cells, that will be actually very important to keep alive because they have their cytotoxicity profile. And of course, we have to consider the immune evasion, the fact that there is an upregulation of this checkpoint inhibitor ligand in myeloma cells, and of course, the toxicity, the autoimmune, this cytokine release syndrome that has been reported to consider. But one note, all this trial been all designed in relapse refractory myeloma. And these are the patients where we have higher resistant mechanisms, suggesting that maybe if we use this intervention earlier on, we may be even more successful. So to conclude, I would like to say you have seen that all immunotherapy strategy have, of course, give us encouraging results. There is, of course, the promise in the immunotherapy, different than other therapies, able to target selectively malignant cells, induce a sustained immune response. But I will argue that only if we can combine this immunotherapy or even identify some predictive biomarker immune response, we'll be able to even further improve the clinical outcome. And this is my slide just to of course, recognize people in our lab, our collaborator, our funding agents, of course, all of you for the attention. Thank you.